Hi, Crosspoint PG here. I'm the children's pastor. Did you know that every Wednesday, my wife Darlene and I host a Facebook Live event for the kids of our church? 4 o'clock on Wednesdays at our CP Kids Facebook page. We're also putting out a children's service on Saturdays at 4 o'clock through the Facebook page for those kids that can't make it to church live. But remember, we are having in-person services on Sunday for the kids and Wednesday nights while you are at the small group meetings. God bless you. I trust you're going to have a great time in church today.
Church, let's stand and worship the Lord. Welcome to those of you that are joining us online. Here we go. Hands together.
You made a way. good morning, everybody. Let's take a quick pause from our worship and give you guys a couple announcements. If this is your first Sunday sitting in these chairs or watching online, welcome to Cross Point Church. We are so glad that you joined us this morning. If this was one of your first Sundays and you haven't had a chance to fill out the virtual Connect card at Cross Point Waverly, we'd encourage you to do that just so we know who you are. But also, we'd like to extend you a free gift as well from Cross Point Church. This Sunday, we're kicking off a 13-week grief share class. So if you're navigating through a recent loss and just trying to figure out how do you pick back up and move on from that loss, we encourage you to join griefshare.org. It starts tonight from 4 to 5:30. It runs for 13 weeks, ending on May 16th. Growth track number 3 is next Sunday from 11:30 to 12:30 p.m. Child care and food will be provided. If you want to learn a little bit more about who Cross Point Church is, what do we stand for, who do we represent, try to navigate maybe what your strengths are and how you can utilize that to change and impact lives, we encourage you to join us next Sunday from 11:30 to 12:30. And last announcement, you guys in the front row, I'm gonna warn you. College Ministries tonight, and our guest speaker, Reggie, who's gonna be speaking today, will be speaking at college tonight. And he breathes fire like a dragon, so your eyebrows, watch out. It'll smell like burnt hair. So if you're a college student or you know a college student, make sure that your teammate, your classmate, your roommate, whoever it may be, someone you might not even know, invite them to come tonight, because I guarantee that they're here, Reggie, and their life will be transformed because he brings the gospel in a real and relevant way. So with that, let's have Pastor Jonathan talk about what country we're praying for and a couple other things.
Thanks, Clint. Hey, why don't you do this? Why don't you look at the person beside you and say, I am glad that you're here this morning. Give them an air high five. And you may be seated for just a moment. Well, it's that time in our service where we get to continue to worship the Lord through our regular Sunday morning tithes and Kingdom Builders offerings. I want to say thank you for your faithfulness and tithes and for your generosity with Kingdom Builders. I'll let you know that the youth room is updated right now. The locker rooms are being transformed. One of the foundations has been poured in one side on Monday. The other side is moving. So it's moving right along, and want to say thank you for your generosity with that. The other thing is with COVID, me being out a couple of weeks, just things got out of whack. And I just have to tell you that it is our 7-year anniversary as a church, and we've been in this building for 3 years. And so praise God for all that He's done the last 7 years, and we rejoice and give Him thanks for that. So there are multiple, this is the part of our service where we get to worship the Lord through our regular Sunday morning tithes and offerings. There's multiple ways that you can give. One is on your way out the doors this morning. There are boxes that you can drop your check or cash off. You can also give online at crosspointwaverly.com. You can text to the number that's on the screen, or you can mail or drop off your check here at the church office anytime during the week. Well, each week we pray for a specific country. This morning we're going to pray for the nation of Egypt. There are over 100 million people that live there, and over half of the population has never one time heard the name of Jesus. And so we're going to pray this morning for the gospel to reach Egypt through evangelistic books, films, and radio programs. Let's pray this morning. God, we thank you so much for the opportunity that we have to come this morning and worship you. For the opportunity that we have to bring back our tithe, our 10% of what you've given to us, and then to give above and beyond with Kingdom Builders. We thank you for the lives that are being impacted because of the generosity of people in our church. Lord, this morning we lift up the nation of Egypt. We pray for over the 50 million people that have never one time heard your name. God, we ask that there would that through evangelistic outreach, through books and through films, that people would come to know you, and that you would empower and embolden the believers in that nation, and that you would raise up missionaries even from our nation and other nations to go and to proclaim your name. God, we pray for the devastation across our United States. As people have experienced freezing temperatures and pipes burst, and who knows what's going to happen after all of this, Lord, we just pray that through it, that the churches in those areas would be able to be a lighthouse and a beacon, and that people would come to know you as a result of this tragedy. God, we pray that you would have your way in the remainder of this service. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. Well, we get to celebrate a baptism this morning, and we just want you to know, if this is your first time here at our church, baptisms are a big deal for us. And so when Pastor Dan says, "I baptize you now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit," and then he brings her back up, that's not a moment for you to do a golf clap. Okay, that's a moment for you to lose your mind. So we're going to practice before Pastor Dan actually does it. So he's going to say, "I baptize you now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit." That's good. That's good. Pastor Dan, take it away.
Awesome. Praise God. I love water baptisms. And you know what? If you've asked Jesus Christ to be Lord of your life and you've never been water baptized, please let us know. We'll find a date. We'll make it happen and get you water baptized. Well, I'm really excited. I have this awesome girl right here named Cora, and she loves Jesus. And so, Cora, have you asked Jesus Christ to be Lord of your life?
Yes.
Awesome. Do you commit, Cora, to follow Jesus Christ for the rest of the days of your life? Cora, upon your confession of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Please stand as we continue to worship.
Getting ready.
Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my
Let's let the whole city hear it. Sing a little louder. Gonna sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemy.
Gonna sing a little louder.
Louder, louder than
louder. I'm gonna sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
I'm gonna sing a little louder.
Yeah, come tonight for me.
Sing a little louder.
I'm gonna sing in the middle.
Hallelujah. Thank you all for singing along and clapping and getting into it. I don't know about you guys, I got the winter blues at this point. Starting to, so it's exactly what I need, so thank you. I'm sure that there are other people in here that need it too. In fact, I'm sure that pretty much every single body in here needs it. Needs this space, needs this place to keep growing, needs our voices to keep growing when we're worshiping and praying and praising and speaking truth into the world full of lies. We get the opportunity to do that, and so we raise a hallelujah. And we raise a hallelujah because we know that there is always somebody with us when we're celebrating in seasons of peace and contentedness and love and joy where we don't feel like we're suffering or struggling. But we also raise a hallelujah in the middle of the seasons that are not like that, where we are suffering and we know it and we're looking around at the world and it seems like everybody else is doing fine and we're feeling like we're suffering and we don't know why. We're grieving, we're dealing with anxiety, can't sleep. Food isn't as good as it was. Money's tight. But there's another in those fires. And we know that, and we're going to declare that now. We're going to praise the Father that we know is in the fire with us always. Let's worship. Jesus, we know that you're with us. In this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. Another in the fire, standing next to me. There was another in the water, holding back the sea. Should I ever need remind? There another died for me. There is another in the fire. Give him a chance and I'll show you it. I promise. All my debt. All my debt left for dead beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. Amen. What remains of me in this reckoning? Either way, I won't bow to the things of this world. And I know, yes, I know I'll never be alone. With another in the fire standing next to me, there was another in the waters holding back the sea. Cross that bears the burden, where another died for me, another in the fire. Whoa, there's another in the fire. Whoa, there's another in the fire. I can see the light, I can see the light in the darkness, as the darkness bows to head. And I can hear the roar in the heavens, come on, that space between where it's led. And I can feel the ground shake beneath us, as the prison walls cave in. Nothing stands between us, oh, nothing stands between us. There's no other name. Here we go. There is no other name but the name that is Jesus. He who was, he who was and still is and will be through it all. So come on, lay in the space between all these things unseen and this reckoning. I know I will never be alone. Do you know it? Declare it. Remind yourself. Yes, I know I will never be alone. Be another in the fire. Standing next to me. Be another in the waters. Holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding? How good you've been to me. Count the joy, come every battle. Cause I know that's where you'll be. I can see, and I can see the light in the darkness. And I can hear the roar in the heavens. And the space between where it's been. I can feel the ground shake beneath us. They're coming down. Nothing stands between us. Nothing stands between us. Oh, when he's standing next to me. Count the joy, come every battle, cause we know that's where you'll be. Count the joy, come every single battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. Yeah, can we raise a hallelujah?
Wow. Thank you, worship team. You may be seated. What a powerful moment. And I'm telling you, it's just getting started. So last night, Pastor Madison and my son Jacob and Tyler and I had the opportunity to go to Iowa City for a youth and student, a youth and children's ministry leadership training. And Reggie Dabbs spoke at it, and it was phenomenal. And then we got to hear stories for an hour and 45 minutes last night that will absolutely blow your mind. So let me tell you a little bit about Reggie. Reggie has been, number one, CNN says that Reggie Dabbs is the number one public school motivational speaker in the world. Yeah. Reggie's been doing youth conventions since I was a teenager and even before that. So I remember as a teenager, look at you. As a teenager, Reggie would speak at our youth conventions and youth camps, and so I've been able to follow him from a distance for years. So also about Reggie, Reggie has spoken to 1.5 million students across the U.S. every single year. For the last 15 years, he has spoken to every one of the Super Bowl teams right before the Super Bowl. This year, Rob Gronkowski walks by Reggie Dabbs and says, "Oh, it's you? I got to go get Brady." And he walks to the locker room and grabs Tom Brady out of the locker room and brings him into the deal where Reggie's about to speak. But let me tell you something. Like, that's cool. But I'm going to tell you that the 1.5 million students that he's spoken to, the famous people that he's been in the room with, pales in comparison to the time that he spent with Jesus. And I'm just telling you, in preparation for this service, it is clear that he has spent time with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and he is bringing a fresh word for our church this morning. Would you join me in welcoming to the stage Reggie Dabbs as he comes to preach?
That's it. You're on the road. Get back your bag.
All right.
I went to school. Hey, good morning. I'm going to be honest. I'm trying to calm myself down because I'm in Iowa. And I'm going to tell you right now. I mean, let me put the pieces together. I'm black. I'm Southern. And I'm a preacher. You got a Southern black preacher in Iowa. Those of you who've seen any Madea movie knows what's about to happen up in here today. Because you can take the brother out of the South, but you can't take the South out of the brother. I'm going to keep myself as calm as possible, but I did bring my white hanky. Black preachers always have a white hanky. But I'm going to have to go there. I went there in the early service. I'm going to have to go there in this one, all right? So for those of you who are looking a little nervous, let me help you out. Okay, let me say something, too. I love Iowa. Yesterday, they took me to a restaurant, and I looked at the cheeseburger, and there was a word I ain't never seen in my life. I never seen it. I've never seen it. It was Baconaise. And I said, "Lady, what is Baconaise?" She goes, "Oh, it's mayonnaise, but we mix it with bacon." If that doesn't say heaven, there's nothing that says heaven. I love Iowa. I do. So let me help you so you're not nervous. There's three rules, just three rules. Little children, listen up. Here's rule number one. You're going to have to talk to your neighbor. So right now, look at somebody left or right. Stare them in the eye and just say, "All right, all right, all right." Turn to the person on the other side of you. Say it again. Say, "All right, all right, all right." Number two, you got to talk to the preacher. Somebody say, "Come on, Reggie." Somebody say, "Preacher, Reggie." And number three, you just have a good time. Just have a good time. We're going to be all right. Just have a good time. Now, so that you can think about it, every black preacher, we title our sermons. They're always titled. And this is cool. Pastor leaned over to me and he goes, "Dude, every song they sang this morning matches your sermon." And I wrote this sermon this morning. And it just owed me so much, I had to preach it. They had scripture for a sermon I told them I was going to do, and I switched it on them. But the computer guy in the sky, he knows how to find scriptures really fast. So he hooked it up in the first service. I'm just saying, he was moving quick, and it was beautiful. It was good. He's like, Jesus, all right? Jesus has an apple. Okay, so here we go. I'm being as white as I can right now. But it ain't going to happen too much longer, all right? So the title today is simply two words, Silent Saturday. That's the title, Silent Saturday. So I'm going to let you think about that for a moment. So let's get let me take you where I'm from. I was born and raised in Tennessee. That's why I like your pastor. He's the man. I was born on the other side. He's Memphis side. I was on the other side. I was born in Knoxville, Tennessee, in the Great Smoky Mountains. And on any given Sunday morning, the music is over the top. It's a little different from yours. So I thought I would take you there just for a second. I play a soprano saxophone. It is not a clarinet. Black men do not play clarinet, all right? It's a brother thing, all right? But let's go to Tennessee. If you were at my home church in Tennessee, it would sound something like this. Here we go.
Thank you.
for the girl taking a sip of her latte, I'll do one more. You're going to know this one, so you got to help me. Go ahead. Help me with this one. It's a good one, I hope.
Who knows it? I don't know it. I don't know it.
Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God.
You know her. You know her husband. Welcome them back one time. Good to see you guys. Great job. Back in the day, the reason some of you like, do you just pull people out of the crowd and make them sing like that? No. No. They were in a college program in Fort Myers, Florida, and traveled with me for many, many years. It's my fault that they ended up together, I'm saying. It is what it is. So it's good. It's good. Clap for her one more time. Good job. Good job. Great. I say it all the time and just let you know, to play soprano saxophone is it's cool. I grew up on alto. I'm ADD. Okay, you can probably tell. If I see a squirrel, service is over. But when I was like 7 years old, my mom realized and they would diagnose me as ADD. And she heard and read that music and rhythm can calm a brother like me down. So she went and got an alto saxophone. And whenever I got super fidgety, she put me in a room and say, play with the radio. And so anything you have that the world calls you a deficit, or they call it a mistake, God has a way of turning your tragedy into triumph. I'm going to give it to you one more time. God has a way of turning your tragedy, what's a mess up, into a triumph for him. And the saxophone playing is a triumph for him. I played one time, and my dad was with me, and we got in the car, and he goes, was that your best? Was that your best? I'm saying, what are you trying to say? And he goes, was that your best? I said, I think I can always do better. He goes, well, whenever you play in church, you need to bring your best. Because you never know when God is going to look at his son Jesus and say, let's go hear saxophone music. So you may think I was playing because, oh, he wants to make sure he's really good. No, I'm playing because the king is here. And you put your best on for the game. That's why my favorite Christmas song is Little Drummer Boy. And even though it's a fictional song, and if you didn't think it was fiction, I'm sorry. But there's a message in there that if you get it, your life will not be fiction. He said, I played my drum for him, but rumpa rumpa. I played my best for him. But dude, your drum is your life. Live your best for him. Y'all ain't ready for me. Let's do this. Everybody look at your neighbor and say, all right, all right, all right. Look at your other neighbor and say, I'm glad you're here today. Silent Saturday. Okay, now look, let me explain something to you. I like to find stuff that other preachers will never preach. And everybody, we're going to when Jesus died on the cross for the sin of the world. So if you think about it, Jesus is silent on Saturday. The women have anointed his body. They put him in the tomb of Joseph. The cadaver of Christ is as mute as the stone that was guarding his cave. He spoke on Friday, when he said he would liberate the slave of death on Sunday. But on Saturday, Jesus is silent. So is God. That brother, on Friday, he made himself known. He tore the curtain that was in the temple, separating himself from people forevermore. The graves opened up and the dead came back to life. People forget that. I don't know how you could jump over the walking dead like that, all right? But literally, when Jesus died on Friday, God shouted so loud that every dead person came back to life. And now my mind is a little weird, if you hadn't figured that out. And I'm like, I hear that and I go, oh, snap. What about the dude whose best friend died and he married his best friend's wife? Y'all got me on that one, don't you? Early service was like, oh. Oh, you guys are awake this way. HBO ain't got nothing on this stuff right here. I'm just saying, that's just amazing. It's just amazing. He blocked out the sun because of the sacrifice of his child on Friday. But on Saturday, nothing. Now, some of you are trying to correct me in your mind with my English. You're like, no, it's nothing. No, if you got nothing, you still got ing. But if you got nothing, you poll. With no R, all right? That's as black as it's going to get this morning, y'all. I'm just saying. Easter weekend especially, it's Friday, Friday, it's Sunday, Sunday. It gets all the headline, all the publicity. Friday, Sunday, Friday, Sunday. He crucified for the sin of the world. He rose again on the third day. But Saturday is silent. It's just silent. So let me explain to you what I'm talking about today. I need everybody just to give me a hum. Just go, mm. That's all you got to do. And I'm going to let you know, and I'm just going to put my finger up and you just go, there you go. Y'all good, all right? Let me explain Silent Saturday to you. It's the day after the struggle and the day before the solution. Oh, y'all didn't get it. You were waiting to say, honey, I'm going to give it to you one more time. It's the day after the struggle and the day before the solution. It's the day after the question and the day before the answer. It's the day before the prayer and the day after the prayer and the day before the miracle. It's the day after you get lost and the day before you get found. Oh, y'all get me? Y'all with me yet? Are you with me? It's Silent Saturday. It torments us. It tortures us. Is God angry with me? Did I disappoint him? God knows Jesus is in the tomb. Why don't he do something? Or in your case or my case, God knows my finances are messed up. God knows my career is tanked. God knows I got to pay bills next week. God knows my marriage is messed up. Only black people can say that. Like, you messed up. Why doesn't he care? Why doesn't he act? What am I supposed to do until he does? In Acts chapter 2, verse 27, it says this: you will not abandon me in the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. So we got to do what Jesus did. So what did Jesus do? He did three things. Everybody put up number one and repeat after me. Lie still. One more time, say, lie still. See, so many times you get into Saturdays and you want to fix it. You get in Saturdays, I'm going to get myself out of this. I'm good. I got this. The more you do that, you in trouble. Everybody say, lie still. Everybody, number two, say, stay silent. Now, if you're a husband, do not look at your wife and say this. Look straight ahead, bro. It'll be a good Sunday if you look straight ahead. If not, you're going back to Saturday, all right? Don't do it, bro. Number one, say, lie still. Stay silent. Here's number three, say, trust God. Come on, one more time. Say, lie still. Stay silent. Trust God. There's an old lady. She was old. Lived in the same neighborhood for years. Her husband passed away, but she still loved her job. She worked at the daycare. And when she got too old to work, she volunteered at the daycare. But every morning, this lady would come out of her house on her porch, and she'd look up and say, thank you, Jesus, for another day. Thank you, Jesus, for making a way. And she'd go to work and have fun. Now she had a neighbor, moved away. Then a new neighbor moved in, and he was an atheist. First morning, she got on the porch and went, thank you, Jesus. He fell out of his bed. Every day she did it, Monday through Friday, every day. He got sick of it, so he decided he would come against her. So when she went out and said, thank you, Jesus, for another day. Thank you, Jesus, for making the way. He jumped out on the porch and goes, there is no God. They had a little going on now. One day she changed her prayer. She walked out and went, Jesus, I don't have enough money. I have no food. But I will trust you. Walked off her porch, got on the bus, and went to work at the daycare. This guy jumped out and went, there's no God! And then it hit him. It just hit him. He goes, oh, I know what I'll do. He went to the grocery store and bought four of the biggest bags of groceries you ever seen in your life. Put it on her doorstep and hid. Didn't even go to work that day, waiting for her to come back and find those groceries. When she came around the corner and saw the groceries on her porch, she had a Holy Ghost shuffle in her front yard. She's like, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And he jumped out and went, no, Jesus didn't do it. There is no God. He goes, thank you, Jesus. He goes, lady, don't you hear me? She kept going, thank you, Jesus. He goes, I did it. I bought the groceries. Thank you, God, for making a way. And thank you for using the devil to pay for it. I just thought I'd give my black illustration in this service. I did not use that in the first one. Hey, listen to me. Jesus knew God would not leave him alone in that grave, and you need to know God will not leave you alone in your struggles. Listen, his silence is not his absence. Are y'all hearing me? Everybody thinks, oh, he don't care no more. Uh-uh. His silence is not his absence. Inactivity is never apathy when it comes to God. Saturdays have their place. They let us feel the full force of God's strength. God had, if he raised Jesus from the dead 15 minutes after he died, we wouldn't understand what the act was that he actually did. And if God took care of your problems seconds after they happened, you wouldn't appreciate his strength. For his reasons, God put Saturday after Friday and before Sunday. And I realize now that's where we live a lot of times, isn't it? Silent Saturday. Nobody knows. Sometimes it's easier to wear the mask, isn't it? People can't really see what you're really going through. In James chapter 5, verse 7, it says, be patient, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 and 29, come to me, all ye who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. Everybody say, rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Micah 7, 8 says this, do not gloat over me, my enemy. Though I have fallen, I will rise. though I sit in darkness, the Lord will be my light. I love that one. I'm going to give it to you again. Do not gloat over me, my enemy. Though I have fallen, I will rise. Though I sit in darkness, the Lord will be my light. Everybody look at your neighbor and say, all right, all right, all right. Now, I want you to look at your other neighbor and just say this, everything's going to be all right. Hey, see, after all the accolades that he said to you before I came up to speak, you have to understand, people have an opinion. People get opinions of you. Oh, he think he all that. Oh, he does that. I ain't nothing but a brother from another mother. And dude, hey, and you know, people want you to think they live in Sunday every day. People want you to think that's where they're at. But dude, to be honest with you, if you human, you know what Saturday is. You spend more Saturdays than you do any other day of the week. I could be honest with you. Let's go back in my life. I was 6 years old, first grade. I walked in the classroom, bell rang, sit down, looked up at the chalkboard. My name is at the top of the chalkboard. Who cares? Everybody else's name was there, but mine's the first. Teacher goes, how's everybody doing? I raised my hand and said, I was fine till I looked at your chalkboard. I said, why my name up there? She goes, oh, Reggie, tomorrow's parent-teacher conference. Do you know what that is? I said, no. I had no idea. I had just heard a phrase that I would hate for the rest of my life. I despise. If you hate parent-teacher conference, clap your hands right now. I hate that day. I hate that day. I hate that day. Everybody clapping, you a bad student just like me. All you people not clapping are like, I love parent-teacher conference. I used to get free ice cream. I hate you too, okay? I got a present too. It wasn't ice cream. I'm just saying. All of a sudden, he goes, tomorrow, your parents come meet with me for 5 minutes. You're the first. I didn't say nothing when I went home. They didn't say nothing to me, so I thought they forgot. Word. Next day, all of a sudden, I look up right after lunch, and the teacher said, everybody go to the playground. When you see your parents, line up, and I get 5 minutes with everybody's parents. Reggie, stay here. Your parents are at the door. That is like, depart from me. I never knew you, okay? Your parents are at the door, and I'm like, oh, my goodness. So my mom and dad came in. Teacher talked for 5 minutes. When it was over, we walked outside. I noticed something. You know what I noticed? All my friends were with their parents. All my friends' parents were young. But my parents are like old. And I'm thinking to myself, why are they old? Now, brother got to know, but you got to ask at the right time. Little kids, ask at the right time. So I waited till we got in the car. I'm in the back seat. They're in the front seat. So I yelled to the front seat, hey, why y'all old? Hey, young people, look at me. Don't ever call your parents old. If you think they old, keep it to yourself, okay? When we got home, my dad said, we got to talk. So they put me at the kitchen table to have a talk. Anybody ever been to the kitchen table to have a talk? If you haven't, don't go. Look at me, little girl. If you don't smell food, run, girl. Run, okay? I just saved her life. We sit down. My dad started. My dad said, son, there's a plan for your life. I said, yes, sir. My mom looked at me, said my favorite word. She said, baby. I like that. Whenever my mom said baby, my darkest night had a light. My cloudiest day had sunshine. No matter what I was going through, I could be all right because mama said baby. I know y'all looking at me like big old black man love his mama. Yes. I'd love to hear her say that again, but I cannot because everybody dies. And why do we always look at death as like a demotion? When the Bible says it's a promotion. Think about it. My mom cried for 10 minutes. My dad moved chairs and held my mom. Finally, my dad said, tell him now. And when my mom spoke, my whole life changed. My mom said, baby, I'm sorry. I'm old because I'm not your mom. And my dad whispered, I'm not your father. I grew up in foster care my entire life. My mom gave me away to her favorite teacher at school. I was raised by my mom's English teacher, whose husband was a school janitor. That night, my mama cried, and then she said, you have a brother. His name's Keith. You have two sisters, Annette and Jeanette. Your mom kept your brother. Your mom kept your sisters, but your mama said that you were a mistake, and she hated the day that you were born. She goes, it's okay, though. You're with us now. She goes, are you all right? I said, I'm fine, Mom. I'm just tired. I want to go to bed. It's the first time I lied. I went to my room, and all I could think of was your own mom didn't want you. And from that day, 6 years old to 13, I was the worst kid you ever imagined. I didn't hurt people. I just didn't believe in myself. I never said nothing. I wouldn't look up. Nobody ever called. Didn't go to no birthday parties. Didn't do nothing, nothing, nothing. But at night, I would just hear that over and over. Your own mom didn't want you. Your own mom didn't want you. Your own mom didn't. At 13, I decided to give up on the gift of life. It was 3 in the morning. I started to cry. And as I started to cry, my bedroom door opened. Look at me. If your bedroom door opens at 3 o'clock in the morning, you need to run, because you're in a scary movie. All right, I hate scary movies. You know why I don't like scary movies? Black people die first in scary movies. All right, it wasn't an it clown. You know what it was? It was my foster care dad. He walked in my room, the janitor. He said, "I heard you crying. Are you all right?" I said, "How? Your room's on the other end of the house." He said, "Oh, son, every day you hug your mom when you come home from school, but the past 2 days you haven't." And I knew something was wrong. Every day after you hug your mom, we sit and we talk. You tell me stories about what happened at school that day. But for 2 days, you haven't said one word. But I didn't tell you this. I knew something was wrong, so I decided I'd be close just in case you needed me. So for the past 3 nights, I slept by your door. And this morning, I heard you cry. What's wrong? All I said was, "I don't know what to do." He said, "I'll never call you Reggie. I'll always call you son, and I'll love you to the day I die." And he did. That was my Saturday. What's yours? Now you go back. So, but you're the same dude that Gronk go gets Brady and you speak? Yeah. You're the same dude that speaks to all 32 NFL teams every year? Yeah. You're the same dude they invited in the bubble last summer to put it? Yes. You speak to? Yes. Hillsong? Yes. Plenish? Yes. Lakewood? Yes. You know why? It ain't Saturday no more. This too shall pass, people. But when that Saturday, you got to make a choice. In that Saturday, you make a decision. Like the woman on the porch, in her Saturday, she still kept crying out to the same God that was there Friday, that'll be there Sunday. She cried to him on Saturday. When she couldn't feel him, she kept crying. When she couldn't see him, she kept crying. You got to call out in your pain, because that's where he meets you. It's great to go on the mountaintop and be with God. But God does his great work when he comes in the valley to find us. Wow. Let me do that one more time, because that was really good. It's great to be on the mountaintop and meet God, but God does his greatest work in the valley when we come meet. You should have wrote that down, bro. Write it down. Okay, there you go. It's great when we go to the mountain and meet God. But he does his greatest work when he comes to the valley to help us. You got it. Good job, buddy. Good job. Us, U.S. I'd take every moment to make fun of you. I just want you to feel like it used to be all the time. Hey, anybody ever remember the band Hootie and the Blowfish? I nicknamed him Hootie. I've called him Hootie forever. And you know what I just did? I just opened it up in a room where he will never, ever forget it until the day he dies. I waited all morning for this. They told me yesterday they were coming. I'm going to say, I got to drop Hootie in my sermon somewhere. And the Lord has provided. Luke chapter 7, I got to show you what science said. Not just me, it's in the Bible too. This possibly could be, other than blind Bartimaeus, my favorite Bible story that hardly no one ever preaches on. You know what I'll do? I'll read the whole thing, then I'll go back. This morning I just explained it because I had time, but I got a little more time. I promise we're going to go early. We're going to beat the Baptist to the buffet today, okay? They are not getting all the white chicken today, all right? Catholics been there for 45 minutes. They know what. It's just over. Them brothers are gone. They're like, oh, just making myself at home, okay? Luke chapter 7, verse 11. I'm going to read it all. Okay, listen to me. It goes like this. Soon afterwards, Jesus went to a town called Nain, N-A-I-N, Nain. And his disciples and a large crowd was along with him. As they approached the town gate, a dead person was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. A large crowd from the town was with her. When Jesus saw her, his heart went out to her, and he said, "Don't cry." Then he went up and touched a coffin. Those carrying it stood still. He said, "Young man, I say to you, get up." The dead man sit up and begin to talk. "I want some pizza." Okay, I just threw that in there. And Jesus gave him back to his mother. Wow. I don't know if y'all got this, but you will. You're going to love this story. Just let me break it down black style for you, all right? So soon afterwards, Jesus goes to a town called Nain. And his disciples and a large crowd was with him. As he approached the town gate, a dead person was being carried out. Okay, now watch. Stop right there. So here comes Jesus with a crowd to the gates of this town called Nain. And here comes out of the town a funeral procession. Okay, with a bunch of people from the town. Now look at the description of this woman, the mom. It says, I love this, the dead person, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. Now, just looking at it, it's no big deal. But let me paint a picture for you. The night before this happens, this widow is at home. She did not sleep because she already knows what she has to do the next day. She has to follow the coffin of the one she loves. And she had done it before. Did you get it? The only son of his mother, and she was a widow. She had buried someone that she loved already. She had walked behind the coffin already. She had said goodbye to the man of her life already. But the first time she walked behind that coffin, she held the hand of a boy who looked like his dad, walked like his dad, spoke like his dad. But this time, there's nothing. It's just air. There's no one to lean on. There's no one to get up for. There's no reason anymore. That's Saturday. That's hurt. I feel sorry for the first service because I'm preaching this way better than I did this morning. I feel I got to come back and do it for them. Call them and tell them to come back this afternoon. Hey, if you're college age, tonight at 7, I'm staying in town to speak for you. So if you have friends, they want to come. And it's cool. It's going to be fun. We're going to have a good time. And I can see adults going, "I'm coming." We'll let you sit in the back, okay? But 7 o'clock tonight, it's going to be good. It's going to be good. I like it. I like your pastor. He goes, would you possibly stay? You don't have to. You're the pastor, bro. You just go, "Hey, by the way, you got to stay." He's just so nice. Would you possibly be able to? I said, absolutely. Okay, watch this. Dude, I love this. I just love this. She's trying to figure out how to take that next step. And as the gate comes, what's after the gate? The cemetery. How do I make it? How am I going to make it? How am I going to make it? She doesn't even look up. But then all of a sudden, the coffin is getting closer to her because she had to slow down. Because two crowds are meeting at the gate. And I love that verse when it says, verse 13. Oh, circle verse 13. When the Lord saw her, his heart went out to her. Hey, Kenny, he sees you. Even when you don't think he does, he sees you. In the pain of your Saturday, in the hurt of your loss, he sees you. And it says his heart went out to her. You know what that means? He's like, I got to do something. And a lot of people go, well, Jesus just happened to be in the right spot. The brother don't happen to do nothing, all right? He is not early. He is not late. He is right on time. He's not no chance. It's not by luck. He is planned, calculated, purposeful, meaningful. And he put you in this room this morning like he put me here. There was some... Now, you do know I'm not supposed to be here. Y'all do understand that, right? Like, your pastor didn't call 2 years ago and get on my calendar. Because before COVID, it takes 2 years for me to come and do a Sunday morning service. I'm booked 2 years out. But now, I'm opening next week. Y'all think I'm joking. But listen to me. Here's the deal. My Lord shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory. Not mine. Not mine. Not mine. But watch this. This is what's crazy. There was a snowstorm like 3 weeks ago. So I was doing 3 nights for the Assembly of God district for children's and youth. But the Saturday night got canceled because there was bad weather near Iowa City. And it was bad weather. So I ended up at the week before I was here. Booking 2 days at the university I graduated from, North Central University in Minneapolis, Minnesota. They had a special 2-day event. So I'm like, word, I can come and do that. And then all of a sudden, the district goes, what are you doing on the 20th? I said, I'm in Minneapolis, so I can fly down and do that. And then they said, well, there's this dude wondering if you would do his Sunday services. And I said, word, book it. I said, where's it at? He said, Waverly. Which meant absolutely nothing to me. And to be totally truthful, as I'm standing here, I have no idea where I'm at. It was dark when we got here. I'm just going to be honest. I don't have a clue. I don't have a clue. But all I know is God set us up. He set us up today because somebody in this room right now, somebody watching this, you're in the middle of your Saturday and you're about to give up. No, do not grow weary. Just hold on because guess what? God's about to do something for you and you got to understand. Y'all, I read it fast, but I'm going to slow it down. Verse 14, it says, Jesus went up and touched the coffin, and the man carrying the coffin stood still. Now, those dudes are called pallbearers. In a normal situation, you got 6 guys, 3 on one side, 3 on the other. They're carrying the coffin. When I die, there will be 12 and a crane. I did that. I just wanted to watch her laugh one more time. And all the brothers will be going, oh, God. Oh, the ribs. Oh, God. So I don't know if you can picture this. Okay, this is where the band comes in. They start playing real soft music, and it helps me because whenever you play soft music, God shows up. That was sarcasm, all right? And plus the band goes, when will we know to come up? So check this out. 6 dudes, 3 on one side, 3 on the other, carrying a coffin. Jesus walks up, touches the coffin, and they're like. And they're looking at each other. And they can't move. And I'm like thinking to myself, why did Jesus do that? I don't get it. But then it says, he looked down and he said, young man, I say to you, get up. And the dead kid sit up and started talking. I want some pizza. And I figured it out. Do you know why he touched the coffin and made him stand still? What if he hadn't? What if he just walked up and said, young man, get up? They would have dropped that coffin, broke the boy's leg. Then Jesus would have had to heal his leg. So it seems easier just to touch the coffin, freeze the pallbearers, make the kid come to life again, let him get used to the situation, and give him back to his mother. And I love the last phrase. Jesus gave him back to his mother. Nails could not keep him down. The grave could not keep him in. And hell could not keep him out. Because Jesus is alive. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for every man, woman, boy, and girl. God, I thank you that you love us And even when we're hurt, even when we mess up, you're still there. So God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would touch your people. If they're in this beautiful auditorium or watching online, let your Holy Spirit touch them right now. A sermon like this, and if you go back and just listen to the music that you play, I sing a hallelujah. Listen to the songs that you sing. There's another in the fire. Man, you guys did great. Way to go. You could have called me and told me. But it's great. You've been set up today. Now the rest is up to you. You get to respond. But here's the deal. Somebody in this room right now, somebody watching this right now, you're in the middle of your Saturday. You're in the middle of the hurt. You're in the middle of the pain. You're in the middle of the sorrow. You're in the middle of the unbelief. You're in the middle of it. You're trying to swing your way through it. You're in the middle of the darkness. You can't see the light at the end of the tunnel. You're in the middle of the fire, but you can't feel the presence of God around you in the middle of that. But I'm here to tell you, He is here for you in the middle of your Saturday. And He wants you to know it ain't Saturday no more. Just give it to Him. The pain, the struggle, the hurt, the disappointment, the sin. Give it to Him this morning. So I'm going to give you a chance. Where you're sitting is where you came in. You came in with the pain, the hurt, the sorrow. You came in with that. But you got to make a decision to move, to shift yourself to another place. So I'm going to go from 10 to 0. When I get to 0, I'm going to pray for whoever's standing. And whoever's standing, you're going through a Saturday. But in Jesus' name, you're going to lie still, be silent, and trust God. Because He is not going to leave you in Saturday. And you're standing by saying, it's not mine anymore. I'm giving it to God. If you're online, down in the comment section, just put a clapping hands. And you're letting everybody on the internet know, I'm giving this to Jesus. I'm giving the pain. But in this room, you got 10 seconds just to stand up. If you're in the middle of a Saturday and you want God to take care of it, we're going to pray for you when I get to 0. But you got to move. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. In Jesus' name, 1. In Jesus' name, 1. All right, left. If you're able to stay seated, just turn and stretch your hand towards somebody standing and let's pray together. God, you know what they're going through. You know the hurt. You know the problem. You know the mistakes. But God, you can make a way out of no way. You could turn the darkness in the day. You could be a joy in a time of sorrow. You could be their hope for their tomorrow. Be it, Jesus. Let them know it's Sunday and that everything's going to be all right. In Jesus' name I pray. Everybody say amen, 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 amen. A lady in the black and silver over in the corner. I was preaching to you today. I don't need to know what you've been going through. But I just want you to know God heard you. You were praying this morning before the sun came up. He heard you. I was preaching to you, and I was preaching to you. Second row, brother right there. I was preaching to you. Thanks for listening. I was just focused on them. Everybody else, we're going to make it. I don't know if y'all huggers. Y'all might be COVID sensitive in Iowa. But if you're not and you're good with it, just reach over, hug somebody you came with and say, everything's going to be all right. Come on. Come on. Let's do it. You could be seated. I got to do one more thing. Pastor, come stand with me. Come stand with me. Hey, everybody, look at me. I got to ask you this. Do you know Him? Do you know my Jesus? Hey, maybe you happen to be watching this online or you walked into this church today and you know there's sin in your life. Romans 10:9, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. You will be saved. Hey, that kid is fine. That's cool. That's awesome. I love my autistic kids. He can yell, shout, and scream. He can sense the presence of God quicker than all of us in this room put together. So it's fine. If that's okay, lady, he's fine. Let him stay. Let him stay. Please let him stay. All right, here we go. We're all going to say the prayer together. You know why? Anybody who's saved, they call you saints. But every saint has a past word. And every sinner needs a future. And at moments like this is when that collides. Your future is Jesus. And you get to make the choice. He says, choose you this day whom you will serve. So we're going to say a prayer all together. If you need God, this is for you. Online, say it. So let's bow our head. Everybody repeat after me. Say, Jesus, come into my life. Forgive me of my sin. I realize right now I need you. So God, I ask you, let the Bible be real right now. I confess with my mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. That God raised Jesus from the grave for me. And today, it's Sunday. Because today, in Jesus' name, I'm free. I'm free. Thank God Almighty, I'm free. Amen and amen. Clap your hands, church. Clap your hands. Here it is. In the book of Matthew, this is what we're doing is called an altar call. That's because in the book of Matthew it says, if you declare me before men, I'll declare you before my Father in heaven. And we got to do one thing. If you got right with God this morning, you need to declare Jesus before men. But I'm going to make it easy. I'm not going to treat you like I do young people. Young people, I count from 10 to 0. And if they got saved today, they got to run to the front and fall on their knees in front of me. Word. And they do it. Sometimes they try to run over me. But today, I can't think of no better person than your pastor to see what's about to happen. So everyone, bow your head and close your eyes. If you're online, I want clapping hands in that comment section. If you got right with God this morning, you got right with God during this sermon, then I need you to confess God before men. I'm on the count of three. You're just going to look up and you're going to wave at Pastor, and he's going to wave back at you. Until he waves back at you, you keep waving. If you got right, you came in this church with sin in your life, but you said that prayer in a minute, whether you're in the balcony or on the floor, you got right with God, I want you to wave at him on three, and he'll wave back, and then he's going to pray for you. Ready? You can do this. You can do it. One, two, three. Do it. You got right? You got right? Come on. Do it. Jesus' name. Jesus' name.
Wow. Wow. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this message. God, thank you for interruptions in lives, for that Reggie to be here today, and for the word to come out. God, I'm celebrating today the lives that have just waved at me and those who are online who have put a clapping hand emoji there. Lord, who have had the courage today to make a decision to follow after you and to get their lives right with you. Lord, I pray that they will never forget this day, that it will be a historical marker in their life that they will look back on to know that this was the day that the old was gone and that the new came, that they became a new creation today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's give God praise for what he's done. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. If you raised your hand, if you said that prayer today online or in person, I'm going to ask that you would text the word yes to the number that's going to be on the screen, 319-250-8998, 319-250-8998. We want to encourage you along in the decision that you've made and the journey that God is going to take you on. Let's stand all across this room. This message was so powerful this morning that I don't want you to just leave out of here without having a moment to process it and allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you. So here's what's going to happen. The worship team's going to lead us in yet another song that goes directly along with the message. And the Holy Spirit is going to continue to pound this message into your heart that he loves you and that he's for you this morning. So let's lift up our hands together. Let's sing out as the worship team leads us.
He's the God of glory. Every voice.
Give the Lord a hand clap of praise this morning. Thank you, God. How many are glad that you showed up this morning? If you're glad that you showed up online, wave at us, do something. Let's do something this morning. Reggie told me that he's going to have a total knee replacement surgery. What happened? Oh. That one. I got it turned off. Nope. I'm going to stand over here. Reggie's going to have knee replacement surgery. And so you see him walking with a limp this morning, acting like an old man on the side of the stage earlier. Here's what I want us to do this morning. I just want to pray for him, right? So I want you to stretch out your hands towards him this morning, and let's just pray for his body. God, we thank you so much for this divine appointment this morning. It's not an accident that Reggie's here. And so, God, we pray right now in the mighty name of Jesus that you would bring healing to his body, that you would touch his knee, that the pain would be gone in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray as he continues to travel that you would give him the strength that he needs, that you would protect him, that you would keep him safe. For the 1.5 million students that he'll impact this year, God, we pray that there would be countless souls that are won for you. As he speaks to NFL teams and NBA teams, God, we pray that there would be people that walls have been erected, where people have been keeping you from a distance, that when he speaks, when he opens his mouth, that the presence of the Holy Spirit residing in him would break down those walls, and that people would weep in your presence and fall before you. So God, we pray that you would bless him, bless his ministry, bless his wife, bless his son. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's express our appreciation to Reggie one more time today. tonight at 7 o'clock, if you know a college student, make sure that they're here in the room directly below this. The northwest entrance is right here to my left-hand side. There's a parking lot. You can park on the block there as well, and that entrance will be unlocked for them to come. Make sure that they're here. We'll look forward to seeing you next Sunday at 8:30 or 10:15. God bless you. Have a great week.